faster than most, and she lives on the coast.
Always slow to change, believe it or not, because halfway through when Write This One was a hit, which was like the first 10 shilling tour, 10 bob tour, it was like very underwhelming that was. But we were playing a very big hall, it was through about three quarters full. And suddenly, towards the end of the tour, I realised that something was changing. You know, the kids were getting a bit younger and they were selling out the concerts, which they hadn't done before, to be honest. And then I put out Hot Love and it went straight to number one, and then all the audiences were basically, you know, much younger and predominantly chicks, mostly. After my balls. Which is very cute.
The formula began clearly on Hot Love. That's when we first used a drum kit, when Bill Legend joined the group. So the drums came in, that was the first element. The second element was the kind of bass line that Steve Curry played. He played a real solid rock bass line, which wasn't on Ride a White Swan. That was Mark playing bass on Ride a White Swan. The conga drums were already there, and the sort of high backing vocals were there from earlier records. The backing vocals were formerly provided by Mark and Mickey Finn, but now we were using professional people who were Flo and Eddie, who were also formerly known as Marc Bolan and Howard Kalin from the Turtles. That was the newest element, that was one of the other elements, and of course the electric guitar, which had already made its debut one or two albums earlier. But finally it was the string section, that sort of gloss that went over the top. The difference that happened on Ride a White Swan, besides the electric guitar, was we added a little string section, and that seemed to be the little missing bit of formula, and all those elements can be found on Hot Love. And it just got better and better after that. The next record, of course, was Get It On. And we were very superstitious about the strings. We had the strings now on our first two hits, and originally there were no strings intended for Get It On, but the orchestra was there, was sitting there for some other titles, like Mambo Sun. And it took me about sort of 15 minutes. I said, Mark, let's just put this little string part on. He said, okay, let's just do that.
added on, and Hot Love shared 10 weeks at number one during the first half of 1971. But not everyone was happy. The music papers debated on their front pages whether Bolan had sold out, and even his most enthusiastic champion was questioning the new musical direction.
I think, to be honest with you, I liked the acoustic Tyrannosaurus Rex more than the electric one, because I didn't think Marc was awfully good at it, to be perfectly honest. I mean, I just thought he was better doing strummity, strummity, strum on an acoustic guitar. And when he started doing his kind of cock rock macho posing stuff, it just I thought a bit silly, to be honest. But I couldn't really say this to him. But I remember, I can't remember which record it was, but you know, one of the big hits, when he first presented, he gave me the acetate of it and said, you know, here it is, first play of the new record. I took it up to the office, and I think John Walters and I listened to it, and I thought to myself, well, if this wasn't Marc, I'd not play it, so I didn't play it. Because I felt, you know, that I shouldn't allow the fact that he was a chum to get in the way of quality control, as I perceived it, for the program. So I didn't play it, and I think that didn't help our relationship much.
Paul Morley.
I always remember reading in the NME people complaining that he'd sold out and that he shouldn't be doing what he was doing, and I couldn't work out what they were talking about. You know, why are they so upset about this? And obviously these people, it's sort of weird echo of the Dylan controversy, which Marc obviously enjoyed, actually, even though it wasn't as important as the Dylan controversy when he went electric. Bolan, I think, quite liked that, that he was upsetting so many people, and I didn't know why people were so upset, and because to me he was just so fabulous, and why were they hurt that he was in the charts? It's hard to believe that back then these things were really important, you know, that some people hated the fact that he was now selling records, you know. Especially at school, all my mates were listening to things like Led Zeppelin and Jethro Tull, and this didn't actually speak to me. It didn't mean anything to me. It was just too far-fetched. And if pop music is important to young people, to give them something that's their own, we didn't have it then in the early 70s. And definitely Marc Bolan gave us something that becomes very iconographic in the way that, you know, Presley did. And then, you know, the Beatles did or something. You know, people had something.
Recorded in a euphoric rush during a short break in an American tour schedule. T-Rex drummer Bill Legend.
I believe Marc was bubbling. I think he was bubbling. He just wanted to get it done. It just felt good. And we used to go into various studios all over the world. And everywhere we went, I think we recorded. And all the time he was coming up with songs and ideas. And he just wanted to get it down. And we would actually learn a song in the studio. Take for example, when we was in Copenhagen, we learnt Telegram Sam for the first time. We went through it two or three times, and lo and behold, we had a take. And toward the end of that take, the drum kit was collapsing around me, and by the end of it, I was actually supporting it on my thighs, stopping the snare drum from falling over, and everything was falling apart. And I said, well, we're going to do that again, aren't we, Marc? He said, no. That was fine, that was great, just what I wanted. I said, but it used to frustrate me. And we used to go back and listen to the playback. Sure enough, give all credit to him, it was there. The vitality and the power and the freshness was all there. But it's just, as a musician, you think, well, you know, now I know the song. I could do this, I could do that. There's ideas, things I could put in, some things I could leave out. But no, you know, Mark was instantaneous.
Sam was the first release on Bolan's own record label, T-Rex Wax Company, and zoomed to number one at the beginning of 1972. That year saw the emergence of glam rock, represented by Gary Glitter, Slade, and Sweet, and inspired by Bolan's liking for dazzling clothes, glitter, and sequins.
That glitter thing, I mean, what happened is my wife had some glitter on her thing, and I just spit on my fingers and stuck it under my eyes. So they look cute, when I only ever wore it about four times, and everyone thinks I was born with it or something. Well, that was interesting because, I mean, suddenly I found, I said, I put glitter under my eyes and I went out to the next concert, and it was about 2 days after doing the TV show, and the whole audience was splattered with little glittering babies, which was very sweet, you know, and kind of startling though, you know, because I'd only done it as a joke, you know, and I didn't have it on that night, so everyone was probably well upset. But I think that caused a change in as far as, especially with cosmetics, that the guys could go on stage and be sex stars or whatever, being not effeminate, but not necessarily having to have brute aftershave on or whatever it is, stag or something, you know, super masculine. You could use makeup and you use things to brighten the act or make it not glamorous, just more enhance the showmanship of the thing.